now we're gonna, and then we take our fifth wheel sometimes and things like this, but Winnie would really, this really is a good for her. She deserves it and more than, and she'd like to go and one more time see the people that, some of them that we went with in the down in Humor, still around, and some of them are, and we Winnie's cousin have had that big ranch up in northern Montana, and I helped him harvest a few years, worked with you, gonna stop and see them. And it just, we're just gonna go on and actually wind up, the furthest we're going east will be Iowa, and then maybe it's further south, and we'll see how the finances are working by the time. We may even go down to Texas and see some people we're hoping will be there when we get there. And anyway, and then stop by and see Nick and then some other people. This is the trip that we're putting together now. And we're going to leave this Friday if we can. And then, Pastor didn't get here in time for me to ask him to do this, so I trust he will. But I want to say, when I was in high school, when Memorial Day come around, there was always somebody from World War I that would give a speech, or some senator, somebody, I can't think of her name right now, but Janet was the only person, the only senator that voted against going to war in World War I, and she spoke in our assembly a couple of times. There were things like that. But, so I want to take this time and just tell you, well, what brought this on is that if you guys have been watching television as much as we have, you see that there's a group of people that want everybody to write their Purple Heart experience, and I don't know what they're going to do with it, but they want it on some newscast thing, and I don't know if they're going to pick somebody or what. But anyway, Winnie thought maybe I should write, send my name, but I didn't want to, and I still don't want to, so I haven't. But I want to share it with you guys. And this is more than just a Purple Heart. I got a Silver Star out of this thing too. But we were, the 43rd Infantry Division was being relieved at 10:30, 11 o'clock the next day. And the Army has goofy things like this. The place is stopping at night when everything's all over. They go on for another 4 hours or something, and then everybody has to go back, and then we go out for 2 weeks of break. But this time, we had up on the outpost that we had, the observation post, we could look down on a Japanese motor pool. And we never saw a movement in that ever. We was there for, I'm going to say 10 days, I don't really know if it was that long or maybe a week. But on from that outpost, we directed fire all day long, and when we weren't looking for somebody to shoot at, we would take our field glasses and we looked down at those cars, you know. Some of them were Buicks, and we could tell what they were with our field glasses and stuff. But we never, ever saw any movement down there. And now, all of the officers, and maybe some of the other people were going to go in there and get a car for our 2 weeks, rest period that we were taking. So, but that morning, I protested as much as I could, but I never, from a private, they don't pay much attention to protesting. So, I didn't get very far, but I knew in my mind that the Japanese had booby-trapped this thing and it was going to be a bad one. And they also had taken some people at that time, I don't know how it is now, but if you are actually in combat, you get a raise in pay a certain amount. And so they were, some of the company clerks and people like that were going to get an upgrade in their pay because they'd gone on a mission, or patrol is what we called it then. But so there were some of them guys that had never then the first thing I know, this command of the 43rd Infantry Division called me and said, get me an officer on this radio. So I said, man, I don't know, but I'll try. So then while they're shooting, they thank heaven it was only machine guns, because a sniper could have picked me off easy. But I was running around, and I had to go back and jump in my hole and report that every officer that I could find was dead, had been shot. And so they said, in a little bit, they said, can you tell me anything we can do to help you guys? And I said, well, if you connect me to that 55 Hollister outfit back there that we fired for them yesterday, son, and if you'll give me them, I think I can direct them to fire right on top of this hill, and that'll get them Japs out of there long enough if you guys are ready to get somebody in here, because they'll go back in their hole, but their officers will send them back even in a suicidal attempt to fire their machine guns some more. And so they gave me that, and we fired a couple of rounds to adjust the guns to them, and then we were firing right along the top of this hill, and they were all of everything quit firing for the Japanese, and we just. And so in comes, and this is the first time I've ever seen one of these. It was a new outfit that they had, and it was, well, it cost it probably be about a 3/4-ton pickup, but it had two back wheels side by side like this, and placed side by side. They were like this here, and it had a fairly long box in it. And there was a guy there and another guy in a Jeep. And him, the three of us, we started loading bodies into this new outfit that they had, and I wanted to say that there was two chaplains in our outfit. That one of them was a Presbyterian, and he was what we call the battalion chaplain. And when he preached, he really preached. I just